let's go. So our next speaker is Dr. Guilherme Guzzo, a biologist and educator who holds a master's degree in zoology and a PhD in science education. He is currently an assistant professor at the University of Caxias do Sul in Brazil, and he's lucky that I'm here and I can say Caxias do Sul. He is also the coordinator of the Museum of Natural Sciences. So please welcome Dr. Guzzo.
For discussion and material to be read or watched or listened to selection sometimes. I was the person responsible for selecting the materials, so there were interesting texts or old casts or videos, so I mailed the students with the material and a list of questions and topics for us to discuss at the meeting. Sometimes I would give an example of that. The students were curious about something or someone was reading something and they wanted to put that topic into discussion. So we opened the opportunity for them to suggest topics, perhaps authors, ideas, texts, and so on. And then we had the material and list of questions that were sent to the students 1 week before the meeting. The topics were very different in variety. Usually from biological sciences, we discussed things about evolution, ecology, animal behavior, genetics, but in some cases, few scientific beliefs, such as UFOs, crop circles that we have in southern Brazil too, and bad popular science texts, and other topics related to those. The questions that we discussed, we focused more on the hows and whys. How do you know that? Why are you saying that A is the case? Rather than or more than what and who. I'm not saying that asking what or who are not important questions. I think that you should focus more on trying to understand how do you know things? How can you substantiate the claims that you make and the things that you've read or we listen to? At least the participants are free to express their ideas about the topics, and they frequently disagreed on some of the questions. The example that I will show the next slide is an example of that. But we tried at the end to make a synthesis of what we discussed and try to reach some kind of consensus about the topic or about the question. And also, we got a list of things that remained unanswered, or things, or questions, sorry, that were for which we didn't have good answers, and then we could return to them, we could read more about the topic and discuss it in a different, another meeting. That was an example of a topic we discussed. It's a book that was a bestseller book in Brazil, The Hidden Life of Trees. The author made some extraordinary claims about the capacity of trees to communicate, attributing to trees some human-like traits. And two or three students were very enthusiastic about the book, and they wanted us to discuss the ideas of the book. Initially, was not very sympathetic to idea to bring this kind of material to the group, but I agree, let's check it. But we also have to read more scientific things about the topic. So we selected two chapters of the book, and also they were assigned to read some articles or papers on plant physiology to check about the scientific status of the claims that were put for on the book. And then we devised some questions such as, what are the main claims made by the author and how does he back them up? How can we evaluate these claims? Specifically, to which extent these claims stand against the positions of most experts in the area of plant physiology? Is the guy who wrote the book really knowing what he's talking about? And how can you know that? And this may sound simple, but some students, especially undergraduate students, they believe or they think that just because someone published a book, a famous book, a best-selling book, the claims that the book contains are scientific claims, or good scientific or sound scientific claims. And after that encounter, they understood that this is not only it's not always the case. And then in the end, we discussed how confident can it be that the author's conclusions are correct. And for many of them, confidence decreased a lot for them, I should say. And then they understood that just because someone wrote a book, the book's the last seven, we need to compare to what other people who studied the area really say about that. Where can we find good evidence about that? You can claim whatever you want, but you need to substantiate what you think. And usually compare to experts on the air. This is something we know during the pandemic that we have seen this recently. We also had a different activity in which we invited fellow skeptics, including Carlos Dorsky, who was nicely and kindly accepted the invitation to talk about scientific communication. We also have Matthew Lipman talking about science and civil science. And biology is also a botanist, so they helped us think through three communication. We discussed, and then we had biology 2 or 3 weeks later, and we asked him what was his position and what his leader was saying about the communication capacity of trees. And Carlos told us about his work in Natalia and getting scenes and other things related to scientific communication. It was a very nice opportunity for the students to open up their horizons, to learn new things, to have an opportunity to discuss, to dive a good idea of great names of skeptic area. Now, I will give a brief analysis, or quite qualitative analysis, of the results. The students engaged in discussion and showed a lot of interest in understanding more about the process behind scientific ideas. Many of them in the beginning were they knew concepts, theories, ideas in science, but they were not aware of scientific methods. So they were more interested in understanding how can we know things, how research is conducted in different areas of science. Questions such as how do you know it, what is the evidence presented in support of this claim, and how good is the evidence appears spontaneously during meetings and consequently in regular classes at universities. Even today, students email me or send me messages say, look, a professor said something in the class, and we asked him or her, what is the evidence for that? That's good. Students became more careful over time about the use of terms when you refer to scientific data and scientific studies. This is what we refer to as epistemic integration. This, I think, is one of the most interesting things we developed with the group. In the university where I teach people usually say certain thing is or they have an idea is proved, other thing is under any kind of reasonable doubt. So we discussed about the fundamental science, but not slipping into relativism. Then we can understand exactly how to refer to scientific ideas using proper language about evidence and also different conclusions. So participants created other projects related to the promotion of science and critical thinking, such as courses and communication projects. Many of them are still going on in different areas of botany, zoology. Papers, we have a forthcoming book, we'll talk about it soon. Two papers were published by students in Portuguese. The first one, the one on the left, is the importance of quantified communication of scientific ideas for science teaching. And it was like a theoretical paper, and the paper on the right is why should you know what basic science is? Are the results of a course that three students devised, and they optimized, they gave the course to the community, to the general public, and they got the results and published their paper. We are working on a forthcoming book, it will be out next year. It's called The Universal Science in the Classroom. It contains 13 texts that were written by the members of the group regarding science. It is aimed at students, elementary students, and at their teachers. The idea is to have material for people to discuss in the classrooms, the science classrooms, and it will be free for schools and for students. The book is about to be out next year. Unfortunately, the group is not active anymore. We finished the group in 2020 for different reasons, and our next plans are to create that again, and but with a different topic. We're trying to, we will have younger students, or ideas to work with high school students for next year, but doing pretty much what we need. Like a group of dialogue, to investigate the process of science and foster critical thinking through it with high school students for the next year. That's it. Thank you very much for